one of the few directors I ever met that I knew was a lot smarter than I was. I mean, he really was a brilliant man and a wonderful gentleman, wasn't he?
Yeah, and I was in some years earlier when I was in drama school, I had an afternoon off. I didn't have any classes. And somebody said, hey, there's this great war picture down the street with Kirk Douglas called Paths of Glory. And I went down and the film began, and it, my jaw dropped into my lap. It was the most extraordinary film. And I, the first thing I did was run out after the film was over and look at the poster to see who directed it. And of course, it was Stanley Kubrick. It happens to be my favorite Stanley Kubrick film.
Hey, do you remember the first shot in that picture?
Yeah, you know, going across the trenches with Kirk.
Going through the trenches. And I asked Stanley one day, I said, was that a full magazine, meaning 1,000 foot of film? And he said, yep, and 1,000 foot of film is 8.5 minutes.
Wow.
That's just a little something. It's a something you might find in American Trivial Pursuit.
Never found him difficult to work with.
No.
Ever.
That's a story.
He never raised his voice. He was calm all the time. He was open to suggestions. I found him a lovely man to work with.
That story kind of goes around. I think it's a result of an actress named Shelley Duvall, and apparently Stanley and Shelley didn't get along very well.
The Shining.
Yeah, and you know, it's kind of in there with. I was in Hawaii a few months ago, and my daughter's boyfriend is a handsome young guy, and he's about 30 years old. He's from Turkey. And one day he said to me, he said, do you think, truthfully, do you think that Stanley Kubrick faked the moon landing? I just looked at him like, well, Keir as well, we on occasion do autograph shows with astronauts. And some young guy, I don't know if you were there, I was in Arizona with all the astronauts. And we were doing a show, and that night, everybody is drinking like you drink here. I mean, huge amounts of alcohol. And one of the astronauts is drunk, and some guy came up to him and proposed that question. I won't say the astronaut's name because he's kind of a friend of mine, and he got up and decked the guy. No, he just got up and, you know, don't tell me we didn't go to the moon, for God's sake. So, I don't know, if you're a young guy and somebody's laid that story on you, just punch the guy out. I'm known for not doing a lot of long takes. I don't really like to do a lot of takes. And he asked me one day, he said, you don't really like to do a lot of takes, do you? And I said, not particularly, but I said, I'm happy to be here. I think you're a great director. I'll do whatever you want. So normally I didn't do very many takes. I remember one day my family are singing happy birthday to me, and he said, okay, let's do another one. And I looked at him, and I'm distant in the scene. I'm not connected with my family. I'm out there in space somewhere. And I'm just kind of looking at my family. I'm kind of amused, but there's not a lot of emotion. And so Stanley said, okay, let's do another one. And I said, hey, you want to change anything? He said, no. I said, is this for protection? He said, right. He says, as a matter of fact, I liked it. Do it exactly if you can. Can you? And I said, sure. And, you know, I did it exactly the same way within reason. But acting is, it's all in your mind, you know, and it's one of those things you can't do if you're frightened. So if you want to be an actor, suck it up and believe in yourself.
You might be interested that there wasn't a lot of dialogue in 2001. Why? Well, in our section of the film, don't forget, these two guys have been in space for months and months and months. And they've talked it all out. There isn't a lot to say, and it's just our mundane, everyday jobs running the spaceship while our colleagues are in deep hibernation. So there wasn't a lot of dialogue, but there was a scene where I was going to have to talk to Mission Control. And if you remember, Mission Control talks to us. So I was worried about this scene because it was a long speech and it was kind of technological gobbledygook. And I was worried about whether I was going to be able to memorize it because it wasn't everyday speech. So I went over it and over and over, and we shot it. But then Stanley, when he was editing the film, decided that it was redundant. It was too much like the other scene where Mission Control talks to us. But because of the way I memorized it, now this is 50 years ago, 1966, and I still remember the speech, and it went like this. Mission Control, this is X-ray Delta 1. At 1920 on board Fault Prediction Center, and our 9000 computer showed Alpha Echo 3-5 unit as possible failure within 48 hours. Request check your in-ship system simulator. Also confirm your approval our plan to go EVA and replace Alpha Echo 3-5 unit prior to failure. Mission Control, this is X-ray Delta 1. Transmission concluded. That's it.
Wow. I don't know if you know this, but in all the brain scans which they go through today, if you're worried about something, and you said you were worried about it,
yeah.
Normally that works against you. So if you have an issue coming up, I know this, I attended a lecture in the brain at the University of California in Berkeley, and that was one of the things they made rather obvious. And when I was a young man, I got in trouble, and my mother, I was always in trouble. I was smart in school, but I was in trouble, and my mother thought maybe I was a little nuts. So she had me take one of those brain scans. So the guy, I go into Beverly Hills, and the guy wires me all up like this, and I'm sitting there. I'm about 20 years old, and he wires me up, and then he starts firing questions. And I was always a bit of a smart ass, and so he'd fire something, and I'd say something back. And finally, after about 40 minutes, he said, well, okay, thank you. And I said, hey, what's the deal, man? Am I nuts or what? And he said, no, you have a wonderful brain. He said, I wouldn't mind having it. Anyway, how are you?
Like going to some kind, it was like going to Disneyland. I mean, I'd never seen such sets in my life. And you know, Stanley was a perfectionist, and he arranged for 40 different corporations to make their best guess at what their product would be like in the year 2001. And so everything you saw in the film was a result of all these inputs from a lot of different corporations, Vickers Armstrong to Parker Games, the people that kind of invented and marketed Monopoly. They made up a special game, which we played in the film, or I played in the film, but it was cut, it was never used. But he went so far beyond what he needed to do, because he wanted to make sure that everything there was going to work for the film. So he had many things that were actually never used in the film that he built. And the the detail was extraordinary.
Kubrick's theory was that the more he could tighten down your brain by making everything as real as possible, the better chance he had to zap you at the end. And that was, you know, the audience was sort of brought in. And I'd like to point out that was one of the things that's made the film endure. But it also was one of the things that got partially very bad reviews. Actors older than Keir and I played poker with a lot of older actors, and they would always rag on me for 2001 because they said, you know, Stanley Kubrick is cold and the film is, I didn't get it and I didn't understand it. Well, if you look at the movie now, I mean, not on your little iPhone, but if you see it like we do on occasion, because we travel around the world with it, and you see these incredible 50 millimeter, you just did something in San Francisco. Tell them about that.
For me, it was a unique experience. There is a special print of 2001 where they've removed all the music so that it can be shown on a large screen while a live symphony orchestra plays the music. And the London Symphony Orchestra has done it. The New York Philharmonic has done it. I was never available to go to those showings, but I just went to San Francisco, and the San Francisco Symphony Orchestra, which is one of the top symphony orchestras in the United States, also did it. And to sit there in the sixth row on a screen that's bigger than this tent and hear a live symphony orchestra do that remarkable music, and I discovered something. I never knew that the strange music at the very end of the film, that weird music that you hear, included voices from a 200-person orchestra, chorus. They had a 200-person live chorale doing those sounds, and it was exactly like the movie, but it was in a sense three-dimensional because it was live. It was an extraordinary experience. By the way, I might add, you were mentioning the sets. He made so many, there were so many ideas that came to pass later on after the film. For example, when we're being interviewed by the BBC, BBC 12, I think it was, in the film, which gets a laugh, we had iPads on our desk. There were iPads. I mean, there were so many things. Again, there's the scientist in the early part of the film as he's talking to his daughter. It's like Skyping. I mean, it's amazing. But his guesses came to be. The only thing that wouldn't be true today would be the size of a computer's brain, because of course now we have a laptop, and in 2001 you had that red room that I eventually take Hal apart. But he was amazing. The extraordinary visual effects in 2001, and they are extraordinary, and it's hard to believe, but there is not 1 foot of computer-generated special effects in 2001. Those things hadn't been invented yet. Everything you see in the film was done physically, one way or the other. It's amazing. And I'll tell a quick story. People often ask me how I did the scene where Hal won't let me in, so I have to go into the emergency airlock and blow some sort of explosive bolts, and I'm blown into that area into an airless moment, and then I finally release the air. How that was done was, it looks like I'm flying through the air that way and weightless. It was filmed upside down this way. So that door, that opening to the airlock, instead of being lateral, was up there. And I had a wire attached to my, I had a hidden harness with one wire. And it was about probably a little higher than this ceiling. And the camera was on the floor shooting that way. And I was dropped head first, free fall, while a circus roustabout, parallel but out of camera range, waited for a knot to appear in the rope as it was sliding through his hands. That knot would mean you better cinch it, otherwise Mr. Dullea will end his days. So I was let, and that's what I did. I just fell that way, and then he jumped off a platform and out of sight. And so then I went whipping back up to the ceiling again as he went down to the floor. It was a block and tackle effect.
But I remember the first time you reiterated that scene. And if you watch the movie again, right when Keir shoots back up, you can see a smile come on his face.
It's true. It's true.
It's like, man, I was a cowboy stuntman before I became an actor. And believe me, I mean, you earn your money. I mean, a lot of the times you make a lot of money and not do anything. But on occasion, you really earn your money. And that's one of those jobs where you earn your day's pay.
Oh, and we did it, thank God, in one take.
Yeah.
I didn't have to do it again. You might be interested in a little story about the voice of Hal. The voice of Hal was ultimately done in post-production. We were long gone when the voice of Hal was recorded and it was recorded by an extraordinarily talented Canadian actor who is in, he is in a sense the Laurence Olivier of Canada. He's known for doing all the Shakespearean classical roles, and name is Douglas Rains. But when we were shooting the film, Stanley had no idea what the voice was going to be, and he played around with some ideas of certain actors. He had a wonderful British actor there at first doing the voice for us, Nigel Davenport. But then he decided, no, he didn't want a British accent, so he didn't use him. And finally, he said, I'll worry about it in post-production. So he turned to his assistant director, and I just want to remind everybody that the crew was entirely British. And so the assistant director, he was the voice of Hal for the rest of the film for us. And this is what Hal sounded like for us. Dive, dive. Oh, no. Oh, I can't let you. Oh, no. It was all like this, yeah. It was a little like working with Michael Caine.
The film was made in the UK, sort of down the N1 motorway in a town called Wormwood, MGM. And I bought a little Mini Cooper and used to go out into the countryside. And I have to tell you something kind of funny, just a little aside. One day, I got tired of eating in the commissary, so I decided to go out and hit a local. And I go out in the countryside, and in a few, you know, I mean, you grow up here, you're used to all these little roads, these little muse roads, and you never know where in the hell you are. There was no GPS. So I'm out in my little Mini, and I get lost. And you remember the guy that ran the centrifuge? His name was Lynn. He had bad teeth. But he was the hustler. He was the gopher. And if you wanted to know something or get tickets to a soccer match or something, you'd go to Lynn, and he'd fix you up. So I came in, and I said, hey, Lynn, I was out in the country, and I got lost today. And I pulled over. There was a guy hoeing weeds on the side of the road. And when you're an American, you know, you have these various accents here, and you all know you do. And we have just a few in our country. So I pulled over and I said, hey, excuse me, but could you tell him how to get to Boreham Wood? And he went like this. And I had, Peter Sellers had told me to get electric windows on my Mini, so I went like this. Thanks a lot, man. You know, I got back to the studio and I asked Lynn. I said, Lynn, I did this horrible job of emulating this British accent. And Lynn goes, ah, Midlands. How did we feel the first time we saw the movie put together?
Yeah.
Well, I, you know, candidly, I can tell you that's a very interesting time because we premiered in Washington, D.C. And Washington, D.C., in my opinion, is kind of it's full of politicians, and for the most part, they're basically shoe salesmen. And, well, you can see who we just put in office. I think he wears a size 26. Anyway, the point is, we were in Washington, D.C., and no one liked the movie. And so, I was married to a beautiful woman by the name of Stephanie Powers. In fact, she's done theater in your West End here last year, I understand. And she was sitting next to me, and at the intermission, Stephanie looked over and said, look at all the diamond tiaras exiting. Nobody liked the film. And within about 2 or 3 weeks, the movie was a colossal hit, and that's when they renamed it The Ultimate Trip.
Well, I think MGM realized that there were a lot of people smoking funny cigarettes watching the film. No, they changed the slogan on the posters to 2001, The Ultimate Trip.
You know what we mean by that, don't you, Brits?
But
yes, okay.
To answer your question, I was blown away when I saw the film. I just thought we are a part of one of the most extraordinary films ever made. And I consider myself very lucky to have worked with this genius, Stanley Kubrick.